Good morning. So happy to have you here with us, Rolando Chamorro and Lourdes Guerra, who are two sustainable farmers who live in and work in our province of Chiriquí, correcto? Both of you are in Chiriquí.
Yes.
They're here with us today because Cinema Sanitas felt that it would be important for people who are going to be able to enjoy and be inspired and moved by John's film, The Biggest Little Farm, to see and understand and listen from young people in our own country and our own region that are going about this dream in their own way and in similar ways to John, that have had experiences that may be similar and others that are not similar because of so many of the differences of terrain and climate and soil from in Panama and California, which are very different climates. So without Rolando Chamorro and his wife Gabriela run the Hacienda Mamecillo in Chiriquí, and Lourdes Guerra is the person behind the produce of La Granjerita, who has her own farm also in Chiriquí. And they are they're two individuals that are part of a movement in Panama that is going back to the land and taking into account the importance and the reverence we must feel for the land in this moment of human history. So without much more, I will start with one question that comes from one of the members of our team. And I will, it's in Spanish, so I'm going to try and translate it. The question goes, and this is going to be for the three of you, actually. The reality in our region, in Latin America, in regards to having access and ownership of land is a big challenge for our indigenous and original populations of the area and the producers of land. So John, first of all, to our Panamanian farmers, I would like you to speak to that, if you agree with that, if you have had these challenges or if you haven't had them, if you see them around you. And secondly, John, what would be great is if, what would you do? How was it for you, the process in acquiring this land? And how did you manage to reach this dream and have your farm? So first I'm gonna go to Rolando and Lourdes. And John, so they may speak in Spanish sometimes and I'll translate. And they will speak in English when they can as well. They understand everything and they speak it, but you know, you're always more comfortable in your native tongue. Sure. So Lourdes, how is it the whole issue with land ownership or acquiring land to work on it? ¿Cómo es?
Okay, first of all, I'm very honored to be here, and I'm gonna tell you my side of the story. Here in Panama, I feel it's very complicated to find good land at a good price. I actually started in my parents' backyard 7.5 years ago, and just playing around with some seeds. And at that moment that I felt that something changed inside of me, I realized that farming was, for me, like a calling. And I fell in love with just seeing seeds grow and everything. And I didn't have land. And it was very expensive to buy. So I found this person that owned a land in Boquete. And I told her, I don't have that amount of money, but if you believe in the project that I wanna do, I wanna build a sustainable farm. I will rent it for 5 years. And I've been working in 5 acres and for for the past 5 years in this land, I already renewed my contract. And it was very complicated back then, and I feel still is really complicated to rent land. But if we look for the way to make it happen, we can actually do it. Maybe it might not be the best land at the beginning, but when you give love to the land, it will come back to you.
There you go.
For me, farming has become hope. You can never lose that hope.
Thank you. Rolando, what can you share?
Well, I completely agree with Lourdes. This is like, you know, when you come and you talk to these older people that own these big pieces of land that they are not using for nothing, and you present to them like, you know, we want to bring the land alive again. We want to get the soil actually start working, and then it will be way easier to plant on top of it. And they just, first of all, they don't understand it. And then they see like, oh, this is a young generation coming with all these crazy ideas. Is I think we can charge pretty good on this. So then it make it harder for us, you know, like, and I think lately the government will start helping, and it will help to be able to increase this new generation to start like growing and farming in a complete new different way. You know, like I think we see it in a complete different perspective. You know, we don't see the product at the end. We see what we need to be able to reach that product. And it's stuff that will take years. It's nothing that will be done in a month, you know, like this would take way longer than that. And because of the kind of the old way that farming has been in Panama, it's more intensive, and it's people doesn't really understand it. But once you see in a matter of a 1 year, a 2 years, 3 years, and you start seeing how it's really increasing, and you know how actually start making it easier to do it, then is when you realize it, like, wow, you know, I will sign in blind in any contract if I can get a big piece of land, because I know I will make it produce. So that's something that we are fighting, the new generation here in Panama, we're fighting with that. But the more people start pushing that way, I think the easier it will make. So we definitely love it. We love it. We start as the beginning, like, this was a complete new challenge for us, how to find the land. It was a really, wow, it was nothing really planned, you know. I work in tourists, adventure tourists, and just by a coincidence, I ended up renting a place for lodging, like, clients, and then the person in charge of renting this place, he was like, oh, you know, I'm on the real estate, and we're looking some land, and that's how we end here. Out of what is right now Hacienda Mamecillo. It was really by lucky. We're like in a really blessed piece of land, nothing big, but you know, we're trying to make the most profitable for the land, and also to really regenerate the land, you know, like something that doesn't matter if Gabriela and I were here, this would still be producing. Doesn't need us. It needs something way more smaller than us, but something way more kind of important, you know, to making it really produce. So this has been a complete challenge, and we love it. Every day is a challenge, but that is what keeps us going on, you know, it's that.
So, yeah, I see so many similarities from what you shared previously with us, John. With you, how was it acquiring this land? What was that process like? Did you have people that helped you, that had faith in what you and Molly wanted to do?
Yeah, I mean, our situation, you know, unfortunately, is so unlikely, you know, that we would find an investor who would be willing to buy the land and have us partner in the business of the farming, you know, and that's the challenge. Like, you, there's like three ways to get land. You inherit it, you go to a bank and get a loan, or you have an investor, you know, either buy it or you are partnered with them on sort of the regeneration of it. And I think what these farmers are showing and what others here in the States are showing is that this is actually a way to increase land value. You're increasing nutrient density of food, you're fixing, you know, ecosystems, you know, there's all these sort of services that it provides. And the thing that's driving it, it's impossible. The thing that's driving this for us in the United States to making it impossible for young farmers and indigenous cultures to get back on the land are the federal subsidies that encourage large scale agricultural corporations to purchase massive amounts of land to get more subsidies. Right. And mm-hmm. it's like a welfare for these large corporations, and that squeezes the small farmer out. So if we didn't have our investors that were very unique to find, like, we wouldn't have had this opportunity. So I'm with these guys that, you know, these are the types of stories that we need to tell the public and the, you know, federal subsidy officials that are making these decisions, because these are the young minds that can see the potential in this. That's who we want on the land for the future.
Definitely. Definitely. Now, Lourdes and Rolando, I would really love to hear from you, since you saw the film and just heard John's Q&A with me. It's what similarities, what life experiences did you find that could connect to what John has been sharing and what the film showed us and gave us? How did you identify with the film?
Okay. For me, at the beginning, it was really complicated because I didn't have any agricultural background. So when I saw all the challenges that you presented in the movie, like all the bugs eating the nectarines and stuff, I felt like I was there. Or when the little pigs were hurting, or the goats, I was like, for me, sometimes has been frustrating the fact that I don't know the answer right away, but I have learned to love that, because it's like I could go to the strawberry fields and just walk around, and I could see a plant like 10 feet away from me, and I would know that something's going on right there. And that's something that you learn with days and days of being working in the field, and it's priceless. It's amazing to be able to connect with something so pure, but at the end, at the same time, so basic. And I feel we as human beings need to connect that way again in order to make a better impact or a better world. Or, I mean, I don't want it to sound like a cliche, but it is true. I feel we need to do more farming in this way to make a better society.
Cliches are true.
Yeah.
By the way.
Right. True.
Rolando, what aspects of the film? Thank you so much, Lourdes. Thank you very much, Rolando. What aspects of the film did you connect with?
Oh my God! We connect with the whole film. Like, you know, we have passed from everything. Like, you know, just starting the idea. Like, either of the two. We don't have like farming backgrounds, you know. No. Gabriela, she's an osteopath. I'm a graphic designer and aviation. So we don't really have nothing really with farming. I moved to Boquete because of my job, adventure tourist. That's how I end in Boquete. I'm from Panama City. But I came here and I could feel that connection with nature right away. So I was like, I wanted to start, you know, farming, and I start from little things to big things. And definitely at this moment, we are in a really huge thing that we're still trying to understand how to run it. And every day is a challenge. But you know what? Like, when I saw the filming and I was like, wow, like, you know, John he's losing like, you know, 50 chickens, 60 chickens. We lost 10 and we're already crying. So I was like, And you could see that he still have that kind of energy and saying like, and he feel like that. It's like, you know, the more difficult it get, the more you wanted to do it. It's a personal challenge. So that's how we started to feeling it. And we are like, you know what? Like, no, we need to figure out this. Like, yeah, there is some wild animals eating the chickens. Like, okay, we need to make everybody happy. The wild animal happy and our chickens. So we can deal with it. And that's what we have been doing for the last 8 years, you know. This is nothing that we study, but every day we get more in love on this way to farming. And we, you know, you taste it, you see it, and it's like I wish could it be easy to present everybody this experience, you know, and people can see it and people can say, like, you know, the best tomato of my life, it will be the one I grow from seed. And it's, yeah, it may not be your brand that you will sell to supermarkets or like you will make it huge, but still that will make a connection with the nature that you will never forget and you will appreciate it in the most small kind of perspective, you know, because we have to understand this whole nature thing is a lot of things that, yeah, a lot of things we can see, but most of it, we cannot really see it as just with our eyes, you know. It's something of giving the time to let it develop, you know.
Is it the experience of the three of you that, because there's a scene sequence in the film in which you start selling your produce, and it's very popular and it sells very fast. So, Lourdes, for example, when I told my daughter that you were going to be, my daughter is a young filmmaker and she's very healthy and very, she only eats organic. I mean, she tries, we all try. And she said, oh, La Granjerita, I've seen her. I love it. I love her produce. I love what she does. And I was like, wow, I didn't know you knew that, right? So my question is, with these examples, this example that I just gave, is do you perceive, and John as well, that human beings will respond to your produce in a more powerful way? Do you think it's because it's in to eat organic, or, you know, everybody knows it's healthier, or because there's something, and I'm going to go all kinds of Ouija board and mystical and esoteric here, but, you know, it's all science, really. Or do you think that there is something really that transcends the process of you farming your land and then putting it out there for others to have the opportunity to buy it? And there's not that much of it that I think, and that's something I would like to discuss with you, that issue that it's so limited.
Yes, I think it's a combination of all. Because what I'm trying to do, and I'm sure everybody's trying to do it, is we want to tell the story behind what we grow, how we grow it, how we take care of it, and why it's different than conventional farming. For example, when we receive tourists here at the farm and we take them around and they can eat a radish, or you see little kids or grown-ups pulling a carrot, how their faces glow up just for the fact for doing, oh, this is how you reach out food from the soil. And that changes their mindset about food consumption. And I believe everything is about education. We need to educate our consumers the important that is having a sustainable farm. And we might not have cauliflowers 12 months or 4 months because of the season changing, or because we want to take it out and we want to rotate the crops and we want to do new seeds. It's telling consumers, this is what I have right now for you. This is the story behind it. And and it's as good as it is. It's very simple, but it's more than what we used to have. Here in Panama, we don't have classes in school for kids about agriculture, which I think we need to promote those because it's very important to teach people how to grow their own food.
Rolando, Gabby?
I think we completely agree with it, because that's the thing, like when people like, and we get visitors from, you know, I would not say from all over the world, we wish, but the ones that come from Panama City and, you know, kids seeing like where the egg actually come from, that it's not from a carton box, and where the milk he come from, where a chicken, you know, how the chicken live, how a pig will live, like, and when they can make that connection, and it's what Lourdes say, you know, if they pull a carrot, they normally will see it clean, wash, like fresh, and in a nice arrangement in a supermarket. When then people can actually pull it out from the ground, and when they see the greens, and they're pulling that greens, and then they actually see the carrots under, they're like, wow, this like, and it's like, this is a day, kind of daily thing for us, but that people from the city can see it, and actually what we do is like we encourage it, and people say like, oh no, you know, but we're Panama City, that stuff doesn't grow there, and what I say is like, no, what doesn't grow is what you don't plant it. So if you don't really give a try, you cannot really say that we don't really grow. And we have sent people to Panama City with a strawberry plant, and they're like, yeah, but it's not the cold weather. And I'm like, yeah, I completely agree with you. It's not the cold weather. You wouldn't get this 100-point strawberry grow at Panama City at sea level, but you will get a strawberry. I believe it, you know? And yeah, it may be the more sour strawberry, but you will enjoy it. You will love it because you grow it. And that's the thing, you know? People can grow lettuce. People can grow pineapple. People can grow cucumber, you know, like, there's so many things, cucumbers, there's stuff that are so easy to grow. And yeah, and I tell people, it's like, of course, in an apartment that you have maybe 100 square meters, I can guarantee you would not be self-sufficient, because like here we have a hectare and we are not self-sufficient, but it's like, but at least you will get that appreciation, you know, and you will understand it more. And when you see a veggie, and Lourdes know about this, but when you see a veggie that is not perfect, you know, it's not the illustrator veggie, you know, that's the best one, actually, you know, get that difference, that's the one really clean, you know, let a couple bites from both, that's good, you're sharing with nature, but that's the one that will be really healthy, you know, don't get the shiny one that is like, almost like a computer make, you know, that's not the healthier one, you know, and I think Lourdes has been making actually something really nice, that we have been seeing, and all these books for kids, because that's what we need. We need education. And it's hard to get to the older ones. The older ones, you tell them like, oh, let's go to organic production. That doesn't work. But tell that to a kid. Let's do it organically. Let's work, you know, in harmony with the environment. And they will don't get any limitations on their mind. They will say, this is possible. This we can do it. So I think that's the way to go at that. And that's the way to involve the people, you know, on all this movement to, and not necessary to grow organically, but at least you can do it way cleaner than like an industrial agriculture, you know?
John, your film, has it been shared with young audiences?
Yes, and I think that's like what was so important to me, because I think they already are, like Rolando was saying, they're not, coming with any sort of stigmas or jadedness around this idea of nature being as important as it is. They get it. They see it. So they are way more open to this thing. I just wanted to comment on what they were saying. It's so true. Like, I always find, tell me if you all agree, but like, eggs are the gateway drug into this world. Like, as soon as someone has an egg grown in this way, they're like, whoa, why is that egg so good? And then they want to try your zucchini and your tomato, you know, and that you're not wrong in saying that it is like a supernatural experience, but scientifically, like, I was it 100 million neurological connections between your brain and your gut. Mm-hmm. 90% of the happy making serotonin, 90% is produced in your gut. And 50% of the dopamine is produced in your gut. So absolutely, there is a biofeedback of soil that is nutrient dense, deep in flavor, and has the mineralization. If we listen to that, honestly, it is the happy making fuel. And that's what people, that's what addicted us, is realizing that we were feeling so much better the more that we were eating food grown on healthy soil. And that's science, mm-hmm. you know, and but we just haven't been connected to that.
I don't know, I agree, but I would like all of you to jump into that. And the one side of sad side, because I don't want to say down, because it really is not down, is do you believe that this type of this farming, that this produce, that this production of food is takes longer, it takes, it's much more difficult to reach people. You know, industrial agriculture serves a certain purpose, a purpose to feed many. This is more of a niche type of thing. I don't know, what do you think about that? Because that's always, this product may be more expensive precisely because there's not that much of it. So what is your thought about that? Lourdes, please. She's on the top of my screen, Rolando. That's why I called her first.
You can go, Rolando. I went first before, so you can go.
Yeah. No, but that, I don't mind. Doesn't matter. But you know, I think it's like, you know, there is nothing more natural or nothing more real than imperfection. You know, you can make anything. You can make it perfect with use of all these new technologies. But if you really want to do something like, you know, natural and the most kind of organically for to say, I think it will have imperfections. That's nothing more perfect than that. So I think like what I tell people is like, what really encourages us to keep doing it is actually understanding like, yeah, it's not always going to be 100% profit thing, you know, we will never get 100% crops, but it's because you have to understand that there is a percent of that will have to go back to nature. So mm-hmm. you will never gonna expect in organic production that you will get 100% productions, because that's actually something that I don't think is gonna be possible. But when people say like, oh no, you know, organically is more expensive and it's more, yeah, it's more difficult, but I don't think it's more expensive. On these days, we have so many products that are produced industrially, that are organically, and if you see the prices, they're pretty much the same thing, you know? But mm-hmm. yeah, maybe with a agrochemical, you may be closer to the 100% production, and with organic products, you may never get reached to 80% of the production. But it's something that you have to teach people, like, you know, flavor will be way better. Like, it will be way more healthier that the body will don't release it. And even if on the products, they say, oh, give it a 15 days and it will be, you know, free to consumption. But it's not really real. It's a marketing thing. So I think making the consumption, like, or the consumers understand all these parts, I think that's what really would change from a traditional agriculture to something more organically, something more sustainable, you know, because it's not just the product. And that's what I was saying is, you know, it's not seeing the bell pepper, you know, ready to eat. It's, you have to understand what is behind. And if you don't fix that, what is happening behind, it would don't be sustainable, you know, it will stop eventually. And that thing is something more we need to teach people. This is something we need to treat from zero, you know, so it could be something sustainable that we always will have it. And eventually it will start decreasing the really mass production things. And it will be something more communities, you know, like, you know, Boquete could be supplying, and that's the little town that we live, Lourdes and I, and Gabriela, but you know, Boquete is a small town and we could produce 100% of our food. And Lourdes, you may say I'm crazy, but I think we can even give it for like a 5% of a real cost right here in Boquete to everybody. So it should be accessible to everybody, you know, and we should increase the little communities or the little areas of town, and they should have their little gardens, you know, like the yeah. stuff that will produce better in bigger kind of massive, you know, and it will be for everybody. It doesn't have to be something too selected. So I don't think organically production is a selective thing, you know, it's pretty much the same.
Thank you.
That change of mind.
Yes.
If I can say something, I think also that if you would ask the question, like, what would you give to your children, you know, organically or something growing more chemically, what would be the option? I think
of course,
right there,
yeah.
you would have the answer, no?
Mm-hmm. True. Absolutely. Lourdes?
I think it's about making organic food or clean food accessible. And it's about those ugly vegetables that nobody wants. We can actually eat them, use them, and we'll be fine. Nothing bad will happen to us just by eating those. But we need to change that idea that we cannot eat them. And that's why we need to teach. I will always say we need to teach people in order to change realities. And if we focus on little kids, that's the new generation that is going to take care of us when we are grown-ups. So for me, organic growing, it's about teaching and involving everybody.
And the future. So do you all believe that a great answer or a good answer, a good possibility to our future and the way we eat and we grow produce is for there to be more sustainable farming all over? Because there's from the little that I've learned from you, from all of you, is that it's such work that requires such dedication and time and passion that there's just so much a farm can handle. So if there's many more, do you believe that that would be the beginning of a massive change?
I do. I think that, you know, the industrialized model is so extractive by nature and destructive to the biodiversity that it may seem profitable in the short term, but in the long term, it's actually not going to be able to sustain growing populations because it's dependent upon the finite natural resources of the planet. A regenerative model of farming, also sometimes confused with the word sustainable, that focuses on the increasing of biodiversity and the health of soil, will have a disease resistance, a pest resistant model of farming that has a much longer future that can feed the world forever. And so, yes, while we may find that sometimes its productivity is less in some cases, it has a longer, more profitable future already mm-hmm. documented in certain sort of test crops, a longer and more profitable future to the farmer and the health of the people. But also it regenerates the ecosystem that we're fighting with right now, right? It requires the drawdown of more carbon because you're increasing soil organic matter. A 1% increase in the soil organic matter of the farmers here, a 1% increase on their land on 1 acre required 20 tons of atmospheric carbon to be pulled out of the sky. You know, that's the idea of drawdown, right? But then that goes into creating this this whole healthy feedback system of regenerative farming methodologies. So absolutely, it'll feed the world forever.
Yeah, I'm so glad that you, and I thank you actually for establishing and clarifying that it's more regenerative than even sustainable. Because, and our segment, by the way, for this series is regenerate, reboot, you know, because precisely because of the films we have. But yeah, it's all about regeneration and our future. And Rolando and Lourdes, if you could, so we are right now, this country, we've had a very, very intense lockdown, John. I mean, you have no idea. it's been really intense. We're still pretty, I mean, things are beginning to open up. The businesses are beginning to open up, and it started in March. So
same
yeah,
here.
So
maybe not as bad, but yeah.
So if
I have mine right here.
mine is back there. You know, the team is like, do you want to get it out of the way? And I'm like, no.
Yeah. Really tough.
If you guys, if Rolando and Lourdes, speaking now to the Panamanian and, you know, hopefully the Central American audiences, young people that will be inspired by this film, what would you say to them about the future? Because you are living now and you are facing the future in this place where we are at. How do you see our future? How do you dream our future? Let's say how you dream it. Okay, Rolando.
I didn't, you know, I think we definitely, like, I'm 37, 38, I lost the count, but I think, like, this generation that where I am, man, I'm Lourdes, I think we're kind of targeting that future, and we really want to make a change, you know, like, we get some stuff teach at school that it may not be the right way to teach it, or it just got reduced to like a one version of the whole kind of picture. But I think we, as we grow, we figure it out and we could see the other part of the picture. And I think that's the good, you know, that's the good part of the picture. So I think, like, the more that we can teach and that we can just expose either the younger ones or either people same age as us or either older ones, I think it's just don't losing that, you know, that can, I don't know if it's the right word, but that enthusiasm,
exactly.
You know, to really get that people feeling that, and it's just it's a cleaner way to live. That's the way to do it, you know, like.
Back to basic.
Back to basics. Yeah, and you have good, Gabriela have a good phrase of with nature and with us. Do you mind sharing it?
Well, our goal here at the farm is that we should give back more to the nature than what we take. And, you know, we're trying to do that with various methods, you know, but mainly by, you know, working organically.
Great.
We're trying to reach that.
And the thing is, you see it, you know, every year is nicer, every year is greener, every year you get, you know, less pest kind of fighting with your crops, and it's just because you're working in that synergia, you know, like, I think that's a Spanish word, but you're working in that
synergy, in English is synergy. Yeah,
exactly. You're putting everybody to work together there, here, and I think it's something that would definitely have to change. But he's like, this is no competition. Like, you know, I don't know. You want to compete with Mother Earth. I don't know if that's really your type of competition you want to get behind you. But I think it's more like we need to work together. And as soon as people start seeing that, it is something really easy to share, you know. And people will find, like, a, you know, they will identify with that kind of approach, you know. And it's way easier. People will start getting together And I think it's definitely something that will change forever, how John is saying, you know, this is something that will really regenerate the ambient. So we will have it for way longer, more generations than if we just start competing, and it may finish pretty soon, actually.
I agree. How do I dream about the future? I would say we need to dream big, because we need to have consumers and farmers working together in finding what they need and what we can offer them. And by doing so, we won't waste our resources and our soil will be healthy. And we won't have the extremely amount of food waste that we have right now. And for me, dealing with food waste is heartbreaking. And the only way to change that is from consumers telling farmers, this is what I want, and farmers telling consumers, this is what I can offer you in a very healthy crop.
Right. John, how do you dream the future?
I think we're experiencing it right now. I think we're experiencing what I would have hoped for, and that is lots of young people who think this is cool, who are giving up careers, doing other things to come back to the land. Smart, bright systems thinkers, you know, people that can see connections, and that we look at that the word sustainable is missing the word regenerative, because the opposite of extractive, which is what we've been focused on for 100+ years, is regenerative. And that's something that people can finally understand. It makes sense. And I think that that future is right here, right now, and it's happening, and it's an unstoppable thing. And the science now is, you know, gathering behind it finally to understand why suddenly these systems are working in a better way. So I think it's happening. And I agree with them that, you know, we have to think big, and we have to believe that it's possible. And that faith is what's required as the engine of possibility when you're working with nature.
Thank you so much to all of you for this opportunity today, for sharing your time, your knowledge, your experiences with us, with our audiences. I'm deeply, deeply moved by what I've heard here today from all of you. And I'm hoping that we can continue this dialogue because, well, I just want to thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both. Thank you all. Yes.
Thank you.